Okay, everybody, this particular WrestleMania-related video will be me talking about my picks for the five worst WrestleMania events ever. I went through all 28 of them, and I picked out my five absolute worst, the ones that I hated, and I'm doing it in my worst sweatshirt. This thing itches like a motherfucker, but, yeah, you know, we all have our favorites, we all have our least favorites, and I thought it'd be cool if I just gave mine. Now, ranking them would be a little tough, I don't know, so instead of ranking them, I'm just gonna list them chronologically just to make it easier on me, because I'm a lazy son of a bitch, but, so yeah, without further ado, here are my top five worst WrestleManias. You all know I hate WrestleMania 11. I mean, I've talked about it so many times on previous videos. This one sucks. It's an absolute just abortion of a WrestleMania. It is unbelievably terrible in so many ways. I mean, this was the second WrestleMania of the post-Hogan era, and by this point it was like, wow, the magic really is gone. This one was just stunningly awful. God, where do I even begin? I mean, there... As far as the actual production of the show goes, there were audio problems all throughout the night. Throughout the entire show. I can't tell you how many times they cut backstage and like, and to do a promo or something, and the guys would be talking, you couldn't hear what they're saying because the mics would cut out. And actually, at the start of the show, when they were doing the, you know, the opening ceremonies, they got a special Olympian to sing America the Beautiful. I think that's really nice. I know it sounded like I was just about to make a really tasteless joke, but I thought that was really nice. I'm like, okay, that's sweet. At the time I watched it live, I had no idea who she was, and I couldn't tell who she was because I couldn't make out the announcement. And while she was singing, I could barely hear what she was saying because her mic kept cutting out. And that's the start of the show, okay? They couldn't even do that right. And it was a pretty bad start, and there's so many problems with the full card. I mean, this is like one of the Mania cards that literally has nothing. I mean, there's just nothing to write home about. Opens up with the Blue Brothers. I had no idea who they were at the time. Ultimately, I would see the Harris Brothers many times down the road, but it was this nothing tag match involving a team that I'd never seen before. I don't recall seeing them on TV prior to WrestleMania. I don't know. IC title match between Razor and Jarrett. If you've seen one Scott Hall and Jeff Jarrett match, you've seen them all. I mean, they will work Scott Hall's leg like a motherfucker. But trust me, if you've seen one, you've seen them all. And quite honestly, the Rumble match they had was better because at least that one had a finish. This one ended in a DQ, so I was like, alright, fuck it, whatever. Then there was... I mean, there's just so much nothing. Owen Hart and Yoko becoming a tag team was cool, but the match wasn't anything to write home about. Undertaker and Bundy was fucking terrible and awful, and I think it's one of Taker's worst Mania matches by far. Bret Hart and Bob Backlund was awful, was so bad, and you would think the match would be awesome because of, you know, the abilities of both men and the match that they had previously at Survivor Series, but no, it was fucking terrible. It was just them trading holds while Roddy Piper, the special guest referee, yelled into a microphone every 10 seconds. It was, Bret Hart himself said it was the worst pay-per-view match of his career. He said that in his book, and of course that book was published before WrestleMania 26. I should make that point known, but, yeah, that match was awful. Diesel and Shawn Michaels was okay. I don't think it was that great. I actually, you know, I already put it on my overrated list. Wasn't that impressed with it. Then you got LT and Bam Bam Bigelow, which was an awful main event. Nice idea. The idea of mixing wrestlers and celebrities isn't, you know, completely unheard of. And it has worked before. Mr. T paid off. William Perry paid off. They did some cool stuff with Floyd Money Mayweather. Pete Rose, obviously, even though he didn't wrestle. You know, they got some good stuff out of him, but, yeah, this match wasn't very good. LT looked like a guy who had never wrestled before, and that was a pretty embarrassing way to close. And the sad thing is, it was probably the most noteworthy thing on the show. It was just a show filled with nothing, miscues, problems, bad matches. the whole nine yards. There was literally nothing I could take away from the show and think, wow, that was pretty good. It was just a mess. And I know I said I wasn't ranking these things, but to me, 11 is unquestionably the worst. It is just the hell of WrestleManias. And when people say that, you know, this WrestleMania is going to be the worst of all time, because that seems to be a discussion every year, is like, this particular WrestleMania is going to be the worst of all time. They would have to try to put on a WrestleMania as bad as this one, or as bad as the next one I'm about to talk about, because, I can't fathom another WrestleMania at this low quality ever again. We go from the unquestioned worst WrestleMania of all time to the second worst WrestleMania of all time. Funny how that works. WrestleMania 13 Heat. I don't know what that means exactly. That's one of the stupider WrestleMania taglines. I mean, some of them are cool, like Big Time or X-Rated at 14. You know, that's R-A-I-D-E-D. Rated X-Rated, you know, DX-Rated, you know, whatever. It's clever. But it really, it at least looked cool. The Raging Climax at 15. Okay, that sounds kind of pornographic, but whatever, it makes sense. And then you got this one, Heat. I don't even understand that. I don't even get it, but I wish that was the only problem with the show. This match has one saving grace. Bret Hart versus Steve Austin in the submission match is one of the greatest matches I've ever seen. That match is fucking amazing. The rest of the show can go to fucking hell, because it is awful. It is awful. The opening four-way tag, bad match, boring as hell, kind of sloppy. Goldust versus Triple H, unremarkable. Didn't have a very good, wasn't very well put together, bad match. Tag title match, Owen and Bulldog versus Mankind and Vader. It's a match between two heel teams, so the fans didn't give a shit. Bad match. The Chicago Street Fight. It was LOD and Ahmed Johnson versus the Nation of Domination. The second best match on the show. And that's only because LOD was over, as big as they were, in Chicago. But other than that, it was kind of just a clusterfuck. It was a fustercluck, you know, fustercluck, clusterfuck, whatever you want to call it. I don't care. It was kind of a mess. Just LOD was the only cool thing about the match, really. But other than that, it was forgettable and not very well put together. Then you had the main event, which is unquestionably one of the worst main events in the history of WrestleMania. And it's neither guy's fault. I've said it before. It's just they were put in a bad situation. There's no reason to care. There's no feud. There's no animosity. It's just something that they threw together because Shawn Michaels lost his smile. But that doesn't make it any less of a boring main event. And the one thing that main event had going for it, which was Undertaker winning the title, they fucked that up because Bret Hart, for whatever reason, helped Sid to lose, or he caused Sid to lose, because they decided to turn Sid face at the beginning of the match. I don't even know what they were thinking when they booked this. It's just, what the hell did I just watch? And this WrestleMania just reeked of one where they had no plan, and it showed. The only thing that they had was Bret and Austin, and that delivered big, and if it wasn't for that, I might say that this one was worse than 11. But because they literally had to have one of the greatest matches of all time to keep me from saying that the show was unquestionably the worst, because it was fucking atrocious. Oh, and The Rock made his debut at this WrestleMania as the stupid Rocky Maivia, at a time when I thought that, I never thought that that guy was going to be worth anything. When I saw Rocky Maivia, I'm like, oh god, this, yeah, move on to the next guy you're going to push. But I never fathomed he would turn out the way he did, but that match, you could definitely see why I felt that way. It was just a horrible, bad show all around, and fortunately, better years were up ahead with the Attitude Era, but it still sucked. Well, there's WrestleMania 15, and by this point, the Attitude Era was in full swing. The WWF was red hot. And when I look at WrestleMania 14, I see a show that was very well crafted, very well put together, very exciting, and to me is really indicative of all the strengths of the WWF during that time period, during the Attitude Era. WrestleMania 15 is not that. This is one that just reeks of, hey, we're hot shit right now, so it doesn't matter what we do. We can throw whatever the fuck we want out there, and this shit's gonna still make money because we're successful as fuck right now. And I, you know, I guess I don't blame them for feeling that way because they were. I mean, they literally could do no wrong at that point. But this show still sucked balls. So many mistakes here. I talked about it in rebooking WrestleMania, my old rebooking WrestleMania series from 2 years ago. The Outlaws switch, Road Dogg and Billy Gunn. Road Dogg was supposed to be in the hardcore title match, and Billy Gunn was supposed to be in the IC title match. That's what they built to. Road Dogg was the hardcore champion, got hurt, had to drop the title, and now he wanted the title back. So he should be in the hardcore title match. Then you got Billy Gunn, who had just spent months and months and months chasing the Intercontinental title and could never win it. You had Ken Shamrock, Val Venus, and Goldust all thrown into the mix, with Ryan Shamrock being the woman that linked them all together somehow. Fairly well-crafted storyline, and by all rights, this WrestleMania should have had both Outlaws walk out with both of those singles titles. But no, just to shock us in a typical Russo move, they had Billy win the hardcore title for no reason, so he was put into the three-way, and then the Road Dogg won the IC title, so he was put into the four-way for no reason. And basically, it just ruined both of those matches, and you got two uneventful matches out of it that nobody really gave a shit about. And it just reeked of that kind of stuff. The tag title match, Mark Henry got hurt for the first time of several. Seriously, is there anybody more injury-prone than Mark Henry? Except for maybe Rey Mysterio. It seems like every time that guy ever got a push, he would get hurt within a couple months. It was like clockwork with him. It still is. He's just coming off of an injury. But God, the tag title match was a nothing. Butterbean knocking out Bart Gunn was actually one of the only highlights. It was hilarious, but it was just a showcase of why they never should have done the Brawl for All to begin with. Kane and Triple H had a bad match. Big Show and Mankind was okay, but it was just pre-game warm-up to the main event, basically, or setting up something that was going to be in the main event. The women's match was awful, really showed how bad Sable was. Because, you know, coming out of Mania 14, people thought, like, wow, Sable can really go. Turns out it was just Luna Vachon making her look good. And you put her in there with Tori this year, and it's much worse. Much, much worse. You had Undertaker versus Boss Man in Hell in a Cell, which to me is unquestionably the worst match of Undertaker's career. It's the worst Hell in a Cell match. It was awful, and they did it because they thought, hey, we'll throw Hell in a Cell on there because, you know, we still got a buzz from the Foley-Taker match from last year, so let's just run with that and put it on there as an added attraction. It doesn't matter if we build it up that well, it doesn't matter if it makes sense, and it doesn't matter if they can actually have a good Hell in a Cell match. We'll just have it on there and people will buy it because we're hot shit right now. And that's basically the personality of this whole WrestleMania. Saving Graces, it's got a couple. I thought the main event was really good, Rock and Austin. That was the one thing that they had that was really well booked and well mapped out from, really, you can map that one out all the way from September all the way until this WrestleMania between Austin and Rock. And their two paths and leading them into this WrestleMania, and Austin having to overcome every obstacle that McMahon put in front of him to get to the title match. This was really good, and I thought the match was really exciting. It was really one of the only standout things on this card, so I give it a lot of praise, and I did really enjoy it. The other saving grace is a bit of a forgotten one. I thought Shane McMahon versus X-Pac for the European title was a lot of fun. I thought that was a really good character clash from the preppy rich kid and the, you know, streetwise degenerate in X-Pac. Some of the stuff they did with Shane and the Mean Street Posse is seriously some of the funniest stuff I've ever seen WWE do. I mean, yeah, the Mean Street Posse, they were full of shitty workers, but that gimmick was hilarious. I think it was some of their better comedy segments involving those. Those vignettes that they did were just priceless, and the Mean Street Posse's music cracked me up every single time they came out. But I thought the match was pretty good. I thought, and again, it was a great character clash, well-built feud, and, it just worked. It just worked, and it set up the Triple H heel turn, and the Kane face turn, and that translated into an X-Pac and Kane team, and they would be the tag team champions for most of the year. So there was a bit of a payoff to it as well. And Triple H would obviously build up, after turning on X-Pac and joining the corporation, he would build up and become one of the biggest stars in the company. from that point forward. So that match really had a lot to it. So really, the European title match and the main event are really the only good things to really look to in this WrestleMania. Everything else... Moving right along to the very next year, WrestleMania 2000. This is another one that just kind of had the attitude of, hey, the Attitude Era is red hot right now. It doesn't matter what we do. We can literally do anything we want. And but they did it in a different way. They didn't do it in the way where they just wrote stupid story after stupid story or just threw shit together. They did it in a way where they made this card so bloated that it just didn't work and nothing clicked. And what I mean by that is that there were a lot of tag matches where there should have been singles matches. There were battle royals that didn't need to be battle royals. There were, there were no singles matches on the show except for the Cat and Terry Runnels. Why that is, why that gets the only singles match on the show, I don't know. But, you had a four-way main event. It should have been Rock and Triple H one-on-one. Big Show was superfluous. Mick Foley had already been retired and he shouldn't have been in it. I know WWE threw a lot of money at him to be in there, but as far as, Triple H retired him, and he should have kept that heat. It should have been Rock and Triple H one-on-one, but, the card just felt way too bloated to really invest in as this epic, grand WrestleMania. I'm trying to think of so many of the matches just fell flat, especially the tag matches, because some of them felt like they belonged on Raw, especially Kane and Rikishi versus DX. I'm like, okay, you've had this Kane feud that's been going for months and months and months, that goes all the way back to the previous WrestleMania, where they first, started their partnership, and then ultimately had the turn with Tori and everything, but... you would think that they would have an epic showdown at WrestleMania one-on-one to kind of close out the feud. No, they do a tag match that felt like it belonged on Monday Night Raw. And there was a lot of stuff like that. TNA versus Head Cheese, not a bad idea for a match, but it was awful. JR described the match as, quote, bowling shoe ugly, which was his code for, yeah, this match sucks. The Hardcore Championship Battle Royal. This is when the 24/7 rule started, which I hated the 24/7 rule. When they dragged it on for 2.5 years. Early on, it was actually kind of funny. I thought they got some good stuff out of Crash. As the Houdini of Hardcore. And, him being attacked at miniature golf courses. And, a Chuck E. Cheese type place. And a hotel and an airport. I mean, they did all sorts of funny stuff with it. Leading into this match. Unfortunately, I feel like this is where the 24/7 rule should have ended. Of course, they kept it going for 2.5 years. Why, I don't know. And it ended up resulting in about 250 title changes. So there's that. But this match that they had to kind of be the burn off to the 24/7 storyline that they'd done, they had 13 guys wrestle for 15 minutes in a match where the title could change hands at any time in those 15 minutes. And once the 15 minutes were up, that would be the new Hardcore Champion. The winner would be the Hardcore Champion. And if you want to watch 13 guys smack each other with metal sheets for 15 minutes, that's the match for you. It is boring, clustered, and a mess. And it featured 10 title changes, really enhancing just how pointless the Hardcore title would ultimately become, where it would just change hands over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. I mean, I remember at WrestleMania 18 when they were doing it, and, I think they did like 4 or 5 title changes, and I'm just like, Jesus Christ, will they drop this? And it's just a lot of stuff like that. And then you get to the main event, which I said didn't need to be a four-way. And then once you get down to Rock and Triple H, which it should have been all along, they do the McMahon heel turn. And by the way, the match was sold as having a McMahon in every corner with a member of the McMahon family backing each of the 4 participants. And again, that just added to making it feel cluttered. And I was starting to get sick of the McMahons by this point. And when they did the Vince heel turn, I was like, oh, Jesus Christ, we're doing this again. Okay. And this was back in 2000, mind you. We're in 2013, and they still show up from time to time. 7 years after this, they were doing an illegitimate story, illegitimate son storyline. So, but then they did the Vince heel turn where he turned on Rock and Triple H wins, which is like the most anticlimactic shitty way to end a WrestleMania. It was so... It was bullshit, and I remember thinking, like, wow, this feels like it should be the ending to a B pay-per-view, not WrestleMania. Because it didn't really change anything. It didn't really, you know, it didn't go out in this grand fashion. It's just, oh, heel wins, and that's it. And they did that just so Rock can win it a month later. I'm like, well, fuck, why didn't they do the Backlash 2000 match at WrestleMania? That would have been much better. But, okay, worst Mania ending ever. That's what this show has. Now, what are the saving graces? I love the triangle ladder match between the Hardys, Edge and Christian, and the Dudley Boys. I think that was a very innovative, very exciting, and just a great all-around spot fest type of match. I remember at the time, people were saying that this match was going to be the clusterfuck, and it actually delivered in spades. It was fantastic, loved it, and it's pretty much what this WrestleMania is known for, because what else is it going to be known for? And there's also another match that I thought was good. It's Angle, Benoit, and Jericho with... It's a two-fall triple threat match with both the Intercontinental and the European titles on the line, with each fall being for each separate title. That was a good match. It had some good action, great wrestling, and, you know, three well-built mid-carders at the time. And it was a nice concept to kind of resolve Angle having two championships, too, because he went in as the Eurocontinental champion, for those of you who remember that. So that was good. I enjoyed that. That was the only other thing on the show I enjoyed. Everything else, you know, the cat fight between Terry and Kat, the tag matches, the battle royal, the four-way, fuck all of it. It was awful. I was also bothered that they called the show WrestleMania 2000 because, you know, for again, those of us that were around in 2000, if you remember, 2000 was added to the end of everything. It was the marketing ploy of the year. Everything had to have 2000 put on the end of it, and WrestleMania had to be the same, I guess. Although I have to wonder, when they eventually get to the real WrestleMania 2000, are they going to call that one WrestleMania 16 just to make up for it? I don't know. But, yeah, this show sucked, pretty much. And, again, it was another one where they were just writing off the success of the Attitude Era, and nobody cared that the show wasn't that good because, you know, fuck it, the product was red hot, so what can you do? Finally, we come to WrestleMania 27, a very recent one, and one that was met with a lot of negativity, and deservedly so. Yes, Undertaker and Triple H was a very good match overall. It's not one of my favorites, but it was very good. Yeah, CM Punk and Orton had a good match. That match was solid. Pretty much everything else, you know, and I remember when I reviewed it, the main problem I had with this show was that it didn't feel like a wrestling show. It felt like a bad variety show with a lot of the bad comedy segments that they did. A lot of the focus on The Rock being the guest host. You know, like, why does WrestleMania need a guest host? It's not a variety show, Vince. It's a wrestling show. It's a sporting event. Or it's a fictionalized sporting event. It should... whatever. The matches were treated like they were unimportant in a lot of cases. Titles were very devalued on this show. This was the first time that the World Heavyweight Championship opened up WrestleMania, and I remember looking at that and I'm like, wow, they really did that, didn't they? And Edge and Del Rio, you know, Edge just beat Del Rio, and it made me wonder, like, well, what was the point of Del Rio winning the Royal Rumble? And they did a shitty job of building him up to that point anyway, so the whole thing was just an exercise in pointlessness. Mysterio and Cody was but, you know, the core who, you know, had the IC champion and the tag team champions, they were in a 2-minute 8-man tag where they got destroyed by Big Show. So, again, being a champion meant nothing. You know, I feel like being a champion should carry some kind of weight, especially when it comes to supercards like WrestleMania. And it really felt like, look, it doesn't matter if you hold a belt at all. It's just, you know, it doesn't mean you'll get a spot on the show, and it doesn't mean you'll be in anything significant or value. It's just, that's the way it is. We need to have Pee Wee Herman in a bad backstage segment. We need to bring Mae Young out to do something weird and unfunny like she always does. And that was just the main focus of the show. They didn't want it to be a wrestling show. They wanted it to be or Saturday Night's main event. God, I've got wrestling in the brain. Saturday Night Live. That's what I meant to say. And that's the major falling of the show. The main event, too. It was, it was used just as a way to hype up Cena and Rock. And everything in that match just felt like a prelude to The Rock coming out. And, you know, a lot of the computer stuff. The Raw GM computer was like the worst thing ever, and you had a computer booking matches and deciding outcomes and picking endings and all kinds of weird shit, adding to just the ridiculousness of the whole thing. And is this WrestleMania also has the distinction of including what is, in my opinion, the worst WrestleMania match of all time in Jerry Lawler and Michael Cole. I've already gone into detail about this match. It's a train wreck, it's a piece of shit, it was pointless, and really, unfortunately, I think that match is what this WrestleMania is going to be known for. This WrestleMania is going to be remembered for having the worst match in the history of WrestleMania on it, more so than it will be for having Undertaker Triple H on it. That's just kind of how I feel. But this one gets major, you know, points taken away from it because it wasn't, you know, a straight-up wrestling show. They really played up the entertainment aspect of it, and not only did they try to make it a variety show, they did a very bad job of it. So it was just... it was pretty stunning what they actually tried to do with this WrestleMania, and it wasn't very good. Now, to talk about some of the ones that I didn't put on this list that often do get heavy criticism from fans, I'll go over those real quick and explain why I didn't put them on there. WrestleMania 2, which has a lot of problems, has a lot of dead weight, has some of the worst commentary I've ever heard in my life. If you think Michael Cole and Jerry Lawler are bad, listen to Susan St. James in the New York portion of the show and listen to Elvira in the LA portion of the show. Your ears might bleed. They are that bad. They are fucking horrible. And if I were going to grade WrestleMania based solely on its commentators, that one's the worst. That one is unquestionably the worst. But I also kind of feel like this show was kind of just baby steps towards WrestleMania becoming something bigger. I've said before, WrestleMania may have been born in 1985, but it came to life in 1987. I felt like WrestleMania 3 was the one that really was the blueprint for how WrestleMania would have ultimately be showcased. It had the big main event storylines. It had the big matches. It had the big venue and the large crowd and the major payoffs. Whereas the first two kind of felt like infomercials for the WWF, where it's like, okay, let's not do really big matches. Let's just kind of do standard cards to kind of win people over. We'll put celebrities on the card and kind of mix the two worlds. And that's what we're going to do with the first two, especially the first one. You look at that one, and that was totally just an infomercial for the WWF at the time, which is why they didn't do Tito and Greg. They wanted to tease it at this show so that the fans that watched WrestleMania would come back and stay for the Tito program, the Tito-Greg program, and stuff like that. And they just mixed in celebrities to get a lot of mainstream attention. So 2 kind of falls into that category. So it's hard for me to be mad at a show that's really just kind of basic bitch at a time when WrestleMania was basic bitch. So, you know, it has its problems, sure, but it also has its moments as well. It does have some pretty good matches on it that are kind of forgotten, namely some of the tag matches. Go check some of those out. Another one that gets hated on is WrestleMania 4, and I totally understand why. The tournament could have been done much better. It was a little confusing. I understand all of that. And should Steamboat and Savage face each other in the second round? Absolutely. However, that ending was pretty cool. And I've talked about this before, how a strong ending can save a show and how a bad ending can ruin a show. Well, this is a case of a strong ending, you know, making a show much better. Because Savage's title win was so satisfying that I was kind of willing to forgive a lot of what happened. I'm not saying Mania 4 is one of the best for it. It's a bottom 10 Mania that has an ending that keeps it out of being on this bottom 5 list. That's the best way I can describe it. What's another one that gets hated on? I think that's 18 is another one that seems to get hated on quite a bit. And People call that one a one-match show. It was just all about Hogan and Rock, and yeah, sort of. But there's some other things on there, like Taker Flair was all right. That one was good. I'll be a little nicer to that one. That one was good. I thought DDP and Christian was good. I thought the IC title match was good. There's some good stuff on there, and some of it's okay. There's also a lot of dead weight. Austin was in a boring match with Scott Hall. The four-way tag was kind of boring. The main event was a disaster. It is one of Mania's worst. And overall, this Mania did kind of have this feeling of, okay, we don't know what the fuck we're doing now. We don't really have a direction. The Monday Night Wars are over. We don't know what we're doing. And it definitely has that vibe to it. And the main event was such a bomb. But, you know, Hogan Rock was really good. And there's a couple of other things sprinkled in there that aren't that bad either. So, yeah, it's close to being a one-match show. But there's a little bit more to it that raises it above, say, 13 or, I don't know, or 15 or 16. Or, you know, a lot of those other one-match, close to being one-match shows or whatever. What are some of the other negative ones? Is that it? I guess 25 gets a little bit of heat. And again, that one's largely because the main events suck. Both world title matches are utterly forgettable, and Orton and Triple H is one of the worst. But again, there's some stuff on the undercard that's not half bad. Undertaker Shawn is awesome, and that's kind of leads to people saying, yeah, it's a one-match show. But, you know, the Hardy match was good. Ricky Steamboat's performance was cool. Is that about it? That's probably about it. But, you know, Money in the Bank was good, too. It's not one of the stronger Money in the Banks, but that was good, too. So there's some stuff on there. It's just the main events are so bad. I think, again, bad ending, you know, makes you think less of a show. The main events were so bad, I think it caused people to be really, really harsh on this WrestleMania. And there are a lot of problems to it, sure, but I don't think it's quite top five. Not as bad as the ones that I listed. So, yeah, that's all I got, and feel free to list your top five worst WrestleManias down there. I forgot one. WrestleMania 9, that one is often regarded by fans as the worst. The absolute worst. And I can see why. The main event was total bullshit. And just total political play by Hogan to get that belt. And that was complete and utter horseshit. And I hate it. And again, bad ending makes you think less of a show. And people remember that show for its ending. And that was complete and utter dog shit. And I totally understand that. But when people tell me there were no good matches on here, I'm like, yeah, you know, Shawn and Tatanka was good. Headshrinkers and Steiners was pretty good. I like the tag title match, Mega Maniacs versus Money Inc., even though the Mega Maniacs were just a shitty version of the Mega Powers. you know, I thought Luger and Perfect was pretty good. The two doinks thing was kind of cool. And a lot of people have a problem with the Roman look and all the announcers being dressed in togas. And I can see that. But unlike, say, the entrances at WrestleMania 22's main event, I kind of see the thought process behind this, where it's like, okay, they're in Caesar's Palace. That's kind of, you know, I can understand it. At least it kind of fits the setting. And this was also the first WrestleMania I remember where they put a lot into the entrances, where, like, Undertaker had a really cool entrance, and Lex Luger had a really cool entrance, too. And the WrestleMania entrances have kind of become, like, an expected tradition now. Shawn Michaels coming down from the ceiling at 12, and a lot of Undertaker's entrances, and JBL's entrances at WrestleMania, where he comes out on the limo, and the big motorcade at 21. So the WrestleMania entrances have become a big deal, and I think they really started at 9. Except for, unless you count the ring carts at 3 and 6, which, by the way, those ring carts were fucking awesome. I love those. But, other than that, I feel like, you know, 9 had a little bit of pageantry to it, and really, they tried some new things in adding to the pageantry of WrestleMania that, you know, it has influences that are felt to this day at WrestleMania. So, shitty ending aside, it's not one of the best Manias, for sure. I'm not trying to say it is, but overall, I don't think it's that bad. I don't think it's unquestionably the worst, like the designation that it has. But those are my feelings on that. So like I said, if you've got your top five worst manias, feel free to list them in the comments section. And hope you enjoyed the video. God, my speech is way off tonight. I sound like I got fucking kicked in the head. But that's it for this video. Be on the lookout for more.